Welcome to Bethel World Outreach Church. Our values are devotion, diversity, and discipleship. Devotion through honoring God by trusting His Word, praying, and worshiping together. Diversity by embracing God's heart for every nation. And discipleship by helping others follow Jesus. So join us as we're reaching a city to touch the world.
Wow, let's give it up for Pastor Jim as he preaches.
All right. Happy birthday.
Let's give God a great hand. Can we do that? Let's give God a great shout. You don't have to wait till you get to heaven to worship. You give Him a shout of praise right now. Once you see Him, all you'll do is worship. Angels worship. Holy, 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 holy. You're worthy of all our praise. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom. Amen. Well, we've been in one of my favorite series of the year, our spiritual family series. We're entitling it God's Family. I had the privilege of speaking in it last year. I am this year. And I'm going to entitle it God's Family, subtitle, Releasing the Force of Spiritual Family. And I'm going to lead you through six very simple points. I'm so glad God has a family. I came out of an extraordinary biological family. My mom and dad, incredible marriage, pastoring in a gang area. I've never seen a better marriage. My dad has gone on now. My mom is 93. She was praying all night last night, I would imagine, as usual. But that's not the case for some of you. In fact, that's probably not the case for most of you. You know, Debbie and I were born into great Christian families. Some of you, that's just not the case. Just not. But let me tell you, no matter how broken your family was, and you love them and honor them, and you should, God has a family too. He has a family. You know, the verse in Ecclesiastes, and I've added the last minute, it may or may not be in your notes, but it says this, two are better than one. Because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up. Again, if two lie together, they keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? And though a man might prevail against one who is alone, two will withstand him, the threefold cord won't be broken. When Jesus is the center cord in your relationships, nothing breaks them. I want to talk about the power of not being alone. In our Bethel One conference, Coach Tom, one of our great speakers, talked about not being alone. Let me talk to you about the face of spiritual family. In Mark 10, 29 and 30, the disciples are facing the fact of what they have to give up to follow Jesus. Paul never talked about his biological family much. He does talk about a nephew, his sister's son, because he probably lost them at least for a season of time. And Jesus says this, if you lose your brothers, sisters, mothers, fathers, lands for my sake, in this world you'll receive 100-fold houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, kids. You'll have persecution, but you'll have eternal life. What is Jesus saying? I got a family. If your family's been shattered, broken, torn apart, and many have. It's not that you don't always honor them, love them, and pray for them, but you've got other moms, other brothers, other sisters. It's called family. One of the most profound passages in all of Scripture is Matthew 12, 46 through 50. Mary, chosen of God to bear the Messiah, loved him, cheered him on, raised him, yet she was a mom. And now pain was coming to her son. He was in danger. She'd go to the meetings, could tell he's not sleeping a lot. You remember, that's his mama. She knew he was God's son, but it's her son too. Being a mama is no easy thing. Jesus told Mary, Your son will be a sign spoken against and hated, and every time he is, a sword will pierce your own soul. So finally, she just goes home, goes to the meeting to tell him, honey, come home for a while. Come on home to mama. You're worn down. Come and have some of your favorite lamb kebabs. Come have that tabbouleh. I just had my favorite breakfast casserole here from some of the finest cooks in all of Bethel. I'm feeling extra anointed right now, I have to say it. The only greater anointing than the casserole anointing, Pastor James, sticky bun anointing. Yes, Lord Jesus. Let me get back to this message now. Okay. They stood outside asking to speak to him. There's a big deal. Your mama needs to talk to you. It's honor culture. Your mom, and he knows she's coming to take it. He loves his mama. There's no one on earth he loves like her. But he replied to the man who told him, he asked the question, who is my mother? Who's my brother? Who's my family? Now that's not disacknowledging the fact that he has a family. What he's really saying, who in the end has the greatest right to define me? Loved his mom. She's the greatest woman in the Bible. Brothers and sisters all rejected him until he rose from the dead. Who defines me? In the end, does that which I was born into or born again into define me in the end? He says this. This is stunning. He stretched out his hand toward his disciples, the big 12, one of who would curse to deny him, one who would betray him, the other 10 would eventually run. He looked at the 12 of them, and he says, and I might add, there were women there with him. Mary Magdalene would be there, others. Here are my mothers and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my family. Power of spiritual family to define you. You see, I didn't have a good dad. There are plenty around here. My parents just didn't stay together, Pastor. Home wasn't safe for me. As much as we love and pray and honor what we can honor in our biological families, and we do, God says, I've got another family for you. You see, I was never defined. I was illegitimate. I'm not even really sure who my dad was. God says, you get defined in spiritual family. But there's a power in spiritual family beyond definition. There's a power in spiritual family that's just beyond social. Describes the power of fellowship in 1 Peter 5:9. You know the story, you know, be sober, be vigilant. I'll kick another verse in. Your devil, your enemy, the devil, he's around like a roaring lion, looking for every opportunity to devour you. How many of you just know that's true? But here's what it is. Resist him standing firm in the faith. Well, we normally stop there, and we miss what's so powerful. Resist him standing firm in the faith, knowing that the same kinds of sufferings are being experienced by your brotherhood / your family throughout the world. What is Jesus saying here? If you're going to resist the devil, you best figure out you're not alone. What's the lie then? You're the only one. You're the only one suffering. You're the only one. The rest of everyone else in the church happy. Well, you say, I don't know about the suffering. Well, you never ask. You're obviously not in a small group. You're honestly running out of church like a lightning bolt or sneaking out in the last song to get out in park lot. Listen, the power of family is it shatters the myth of isolation. Am I alone? Heck no. Am I the only one suffering? No, I know James. I know the bishop. I know Phil Benasso. I've got all my, I know I'm not alone. The devil can never say you're the only one suffering. I got way too many friends suffering. I got one friend named Pastor Ron Lewis. We all know him. We love him. He suffered so much. I said, man, I love being your friend. He said, why is that? I said, it's like being Job's friend. No matter how much I suffer, you got me beat. I can never feel I'm the worst sufferer. I mean, every time I think I'm suffering, I think, no, what about Ron Lewis? That put it in perspective for me. Now listen to me, beloved. The power of fellowship. One of the great, I've been an elite military, the power of brotherhood, suffering, camaraderie. But there's even a greater power. I want to open your eyes today to why the enemy hates family, to why he despises spiritual family. And this is why. When you turn into Ephesians 6, and that's going to pop up, this is probably the most critical treatise in all the Bible on surviving spiritual warfare. And in this chapter, it's easy to miss, but the power of having victory over the devil is revealed. Finally, be strong in the Lord and the strength of his might. You better armor up so you can stand against the schemes of the devil. Here's why. Maybe you've watched Ultimate Fighting before. That's nothing compared to fighting the devil. They tattoo themselves, hump, pump up, look, hit, kick. That's nothing. The devil slapped them out of the ring. It's a joke to the devil. Your physical strength is nothing to the devil. Your wit, your brain, your beauty, your power, your talent, it's a joke to him. He said, you're going to have to understand your life completely different because the enemy is a roaring lion. Because you think, why don't my friends see? Because the God of this world has blinded them. Why am I just walking just like through a fog storm? Because there's an enemy that fears you. Paul said, let me help you now. And he's surrounded by the Praetorian Guard, the elite. He's chained to two of them 24/7. And as he's sitting there chained, God says, I'm going to teach you something about fighting. He said, listen, you're fighting the enemy. And then he says this, it's very interesting. Catch this, because it's very easy to me. You don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Now, the word wrestling there is a very important word. It speaks of Greco-Roman wrestling. And in Greco-Roman wrestling, two men, maybe a loincloth, maybe nothing, would wrestle, depending on the Olympics, till they choked them out, sometimes till one died. And they would take olive oil soap and basically cake their whole body with it, so if you're grappling, the hand would slip off the arm. What's Paul saying here? You ain't fighting a man. Don't think unarmored you can win. Don't think a little bit of anointing just going to save you. You ain't wrestling with a human. Don't think you're going to get in the ring with the devil all alone and be okay. It says this. Instead, take up the whole armor of God that you can withstand him. Now, what you're missing here is the issue in this chapter is not just putting on the right thing. It's not, well, I got my armor, I'm going to whoop the devil down today. No. You've got to understand that there's two types of fighting contrasted here. There's Greco-Roman wrestling, man on man. I'm the man, I'm anointed. I'm getting in the ring with the devil today and knocking him out. And I appreciate positive confession. But he contrasts that with how Roman soldiers fought. Do you know the average Roman soldier was 5'3" tall? How many of you know Phil Benasso? I don't want to knock my covenant friend, but that don't exactly make you afraid to see him. They all look like Phil, just like you're just marching out about 5'3", marching out to battle. You go, Pastor Jim, how'd they win? How'd they do it? How? How them little 5'3" Italians conquer the world? And if some of you were 5'3", this is going to really encourage you. And the centurions were 5'6". How'd they do it? How'd they fight all these giant armies and win? Here's why. Because from the very foundation of the Roman army, they lost from time to time. The Parthians beat them when they were under Crassus. They lost three legions in the Totenberg Forest. Hannibal gave them fits. But in the end, for 1,000 years, they lost a lot of battles. They never lost a war. Why? Because they understood that if the essence of victory was family, and here's how they did it. Watch this. When you joined the Roman army, depending when you joined, your minimum enlistment was 18 years, sometimes 22. You realize when you joined the Roman army, unless you were really heavily promoted, you could never marry, because they felt if a man's highest allegiance wasn't to brotherhood, he'd fail in battle. When you got there, Pastor James, they'd introduce you to a man. He says, now you're making a covenant with him. He has your will. He has your back unless one of you die. They would pick seven other men and stick you in the same tent, and you'd live with those seven men for years unless you died or were promoted. They'd come from the same area, language, religion, all of it. They fought as a family. They knew one another. Weaknesses, strengths, what made them tick. Now let's break down into that. I'm going to talk about three of the pieces of the armor today, just for a moment. This is the first one. The Bible says, gird your loins with truth. Basically, Roman soldiers had a big belt with a groin guard, and their sword would be on it. But what you don't realize is across their back, they had a harness. And the truth it speaks of here is not just gird your loin with the truth of God, it's gird your loin with who can tell you the truth. Who can tell you that's dumb? Who can tell you that's going to wreck your kids? Who can tell you that may cost you your spouse? Stand to your feet. Some of you know the person behind you, some of you don't. It's very important. Now catch this analogy. When the Romans went to war, typically outnumbered, 3 or 4 to 1, definitely outsized, they had a harness. And then when you were in line, I'm in the front line, I got James around my back, I got Bishop behind James. And the brother behind you, who you'd known for years, would reach up and grab your harness. And when the enemy hit, he'd bend down, the brother behind him had bend down, and the enemy wasn't hitting one man, he was hitting three men. Couldn't knock him off his feet. Now watch this. The centurion, the most experienced soldier there, why they called him a centurion, it was 80 men, I don't know, would be watching. He would be watching to see if the front line was weakening. How many of you know, if you're in a big game, event, stressful thing, you don't even know you're losing it. You can't even tell if you're getting a bad fight or you're winning or losing. You don't know if hard business deals, something tough, you're so stressed, you can barely, that's when you realize they're weakening. The guys fighting couldn't even hear the whistle, but the brother behind him could. And you were taught, when the man that had your back pulled, step back. When the man that has your back pulled, step back, because you're about to get killed, you just don't realize it. They'd pull back, Jane, pull me back, Bishop, go to the front. Now, how's this work? Who got your back? Honestly. Who can pull you back from disaster? Who can pull you back from that stupid business deal? Who can pull you back? Who can pull you back from wrecking your kids? Who's got your back? God's got my back. Well, I appreciate that fact. God had the son's back too in Gethsemane. He still brought his three brothers with him. You can sit down. Who's got your back, student? Who's got your back in high school, college, the business? Who's got it? If someone doesn't have your back, you'll be knocked back. It is reality. You say, I'm strong. I get being strong in the Lord. I've been saved over 60 years. I've preached 50. I've traveled the world. I've lived in war zones and risked my life. But I wouldn't be here if my wife, my mother, my sister, people like James, Phil, Rice, and others have my back. Who can stop you? Who? God spoke to me. If you're the only one God spoke to, that's doubtful. If he hadn't spoken to someone else that has your back, I doubt that. I believe God's spoken. Well, who else he told? No one, just me. It's doubtful then. Who can pull you back? Who can look you in the face and say, that's stupid. Don't do that. You're not thinking right. Who can tell you the truth? Paul said, I told you the truth. Now you made me your enemy. As our friendship ended because I finally told you that you're deceived and deluded. Who got your back? That's why the devil wants you alone out there with some horde of the demonic rolling down your way. You say, James got my back. James don't even know. James doesn't know you well enough to have your back at times. He may get a word of knowledge, prophecy, great. It's the brothers and sisters you're walking with. Where do I find it? Maybe you find it in a small group. Maybe if you just stayed after church some, you'd find it. Maybe if with the Bethel Foundations classes, you'd find it. Who's got your back? I've got 14, 15 people I trust with my life. They got my back. They know me. And I've got the back of many others, including James and Debbie. I wait on the Lord over them multiple times every week, watching, looking, thinking. Secondly, he says, take up the shield of faith, and I'm going to hit this one more, then we'll press right along. There's a lot of pieces, but I want to talk about those which are corporate. That shield of faith, 2.5 feet wide, 4 feet long, weighed 15 to 22 pounds. You go, Pastor Jim, why was that shield so big? Well, that's real simple, because it wasn't just to cover you. When the Romans locked down the field, they'd always keep their sword in their right hand, their shield in their left hand, and they'd lock those big shields. It was never just about you, because you realize where you were stabbing with this right hand, making yourself vulnerable, your brother's shield was also covering you. When all hell broke loose, they were attacking a city or a fortification, and the arrows were darkening the sky, they would get in what they called the testado or the tortoise formation. The front row would put their shields out. All the rest of them would put their shields up, and they'd make a moving shell. Problem is, it just slowed you down because you got to kind of crab walk. You can't go fast. But let me tell you, better slow than dead. And I tell you now, who are you in formation with? Whose faith is covering you? Your faith is not enough. Whose faith is covering you? When arrows are piercing you, all hell is breaking loose in your family. I got more shields around me. I got more covering you. Who? Listen. We're in the first set of waves of epic worldwide revival. Make no mistake about it. The way you see it, mark it down. The waves of God will slap every nation in the world with divine undertows, bringing many to be saved. But there's also a dragon, and he hates revival, and the flood will come out of his mouth. Who got your back? Thirdly, the last piece of the army is this. And after all this, pray in the Spirit for all the saints, for all kinds of prayers. And then Paul says, by the way, pray for me. There are 24 people whose backs I cover in prayer multiple times every week. You say, oh man, that's your job. No, I'm praying when you're in bed. I'm up late at night praying. I ain't paid to stay up late at night and pray. In fact, I'm retired last time. Am I retired now, James? I thought I was retired. I'm failing my retirement real bad is all I can say. Now listen to me. Let me talk to you about one of the most tragic failures of spiritual family. You're never going to get a test without a teaching. Some months before he died, Jesus says, Peter, James, and John were going mountain climbing. They felt honored. Jesus is going to take us up on a mountain. You ever have a mountaintop experience with God? Great teaching, great sermon, great worship. You're crying. Be careful. You're going to get tested on it. They get up to the top of the mountain there in the Mount of Transfiguration, And they get sleepy like they always do, and they slept through the teaching. They woke up, old Peter shook his head, sleep out of his eyes. There's Moses and Elijah praying over Jesus. But they missed the lesson. The Bible said he sent Moses and Elijah down from heaven to strengthen them for their death. Why would God show them that? Because their turn was coming in real time in the valley. Because the same Peter, James, and John that got called up to the mountain for a lesson got called into Gethsemane that night. This is the Son of God. If the Son of God needs someone to have his back, what about you? If the Son of God could be transparent, what about you? The Son of God could be, he said, Peter, James, John, he said, come with me. They go, well, we never gotten deep in your prayer life. He go, I'm surrounded by death tonight. I'll be honest, brothers. I can barely walk. The warfare is so brutal. This Jesus, walk on the water, multiply food, raise the dead. I need you guys to have my back tonight. Oh, how do we do it? I need you to watch. Watch me and pray. Jesus broken. Every demon in hell beginning to pound him. And they're just, oh yeah. You know, old Pastor James probably don't need much prayer. Why would he need praise, a man of God? Jesus don't need no prayer. Like, well, why pray for so-and-so? Why pray for Debbie? I mean, she's the pastor's wife. She's a great leader. Why, really? Go into the garden. Peter and the brothers, they make about 4 or 5 minutes in the prayer meeting and fall sound asleep. Said they were sleeping for sorrow. Stress and pain will put you to sleep because you want to escape it if you're not careful. Problem is, you wake up, it's still there. Jesus is over praying, sweating blood. He comes, boys, he wake up. Oh, yeah, bro. We just closed our eyes a minute. We was having visions. He said, if you don't watch and pray, your faith's going to fail you. That don't make sense. You're telling me if I don't join my church in praying, if I'm not involved, my faith may fail me. What they thought is he just needs prayer. No, they needed to pray as much as he needed prayer. Yeah. Went back, they fell asleep again. The angel came. We got you back. Jesus, pretty good. They're sleeping. Wakes them up again. It's too late. They ran. They left him, abandoned him. When you've been failed by a biological family, which many of you have, you put all your eggs in the church basket. And if you're ever hurt in church, which we all will be, it's inevitable, or failed in church, it's like double jeopardy in your soul. Jesus should have given up on spiritual family. There's no doubt about it. Judas betrayed him. Peter cursed and denied him. And all the brothers ran. You get that? They ran. Didn't even need to run. The whole crowd of soldiers had been smitten to the ground. They ran from a bunch of folk laying around and broken. The forgiveness of family, and I'll get to my last point. Jesus is raised from the dead. How many of you know the women never ever abandoned him? They were at the cross. Judas had hung himself. John made it to represent the other nine who didn't even bother to come. They were so afraid. Mary's clinging to me. Clinging, and she goes, Mary said, don't cling to me. I'm yet to ascend to the Father. Why is it we always want to cling to our last revelation of Jesus when he's got more to show us? Why is it? Stop clinging. I please it. But there's a day you can't cling. You got to fling yourself in his arms afresh. Now, if I'd have been him, I'd say, I want you to know, go to those flakes that used to be my brothers. Go to them traitors, them backsliders, them counseling. Tell him I'm going up to my father. He sure ain't their father, and he's barely their God. So long. You'd have been tempted to say that. So what? I would have. Go to my brothers. We're still family. You go to my brothers. We're still family. Tell them I'm assembling to my dad and their dad, to my God and their God. Family, true spiritual family, we don't give up on you. You may blow it, you may deny, you may betray, but you repent, they're no giving up on you. Just go tell that lump of coward, prayerless, backslidden, abandoned me. Nope. Go tell my brothers I got them. Go tell my brothers, even though they didn't have my back, I got their back. And I'm going up to see our joint daddy. Family can be a fight. It's my last point. In Psalm 68, 6, first part, the NIV says, God sets the lonely in families. Beloved ones, listen to me. You say, well, I'm in the church, but I'm lonely. It's one thing for God to set you in family. It's a whole other matter for you to settle into family. You see, it's trauma and pain of family, from emotional abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse, pure abandonment. I was talking to one of our great, great Bethel members, one of our powerful Bethel members, and one of her daughter's friends came over, a little girl, and she was crying. And she says, what's wrong? She says, my mama told me she wishes I was dead. How many of you know that child just got ripped to shreds? Told a 12-year-old daughter the same thing. When you've been bruised in family, it's hard to ever settle into family again. You've been hurt in your biological family, maybe a prior church family to this. And that bonding thing, which is so natural for me, I came out of a very healthy biological family, which was also my spiritual family. But I've sure had my share of betrayals since, hurts then, rejections. For one moment in my life where I've been so shattered in so many relationships, I thought, maybe I'll get up, maybe I'll give up on spiritual family. You know what I realized? Far better to limp along in spiritual family than to be bitter, vulnerable, and alone for the rest of my life. You see, when a person hurts you, the devil's plan is not just to take that person out of your life, it's to take the principle that generated he or she. I was so hurt in marriage, I'll never trust another man, I'll never trust another woman. I was so hurt in church, I'll not only not trust that church, I'll never trust any church. I'll never make a disciple again. I'll never do it again. If you're lonely in Bethel, you can change that. Well, how? Try a small group. Go to Foundations. Come up to the altar and ask someone to get your back. All the people in this altar, they get war, they get problems, they get hurt. If they hadn't overcome a lot of pain, we wouldn't even have them up here. They're not up here because they're pain-free. They're up here because they've been transformed by their pain, not deformed by it. If James ever got up here and told you his story, what he went through as a kid, I mean, James transformed, walked with God when it seemed impossible. That's why he's compassionate. It's why he's tender. He knows what it is to be swept into spiritual family. You say, I want to more fully embrace spiritual family. Raise your hand. Let me see your hands. Let's all stand up together now as Pastor James joins me. Beloved, I've walked with God a long time. I got saved at 8 years old. And you say, well, you look about 38. Well, you're right, give or take about 31 years. But you know why I'm still here? I don't walk alone. Yes, I have Jesus. I depend on him. But Jesus, you feel like, I got Jesus. Well, that's fine. Do you have his body? His hands? His feet? Holy Spirit, I thank you for my Bethel family. What I'm sharing today is not a message, it's my lifestyle. It's how I've lived. Bring us as our culture fragments and polarizes. Bring us to such a place of family that the force of family becomes an irresistible pull in a broken culture. We submit to your mission and your mandate, Lord.